So now it's all neat that we have this login user, but there are some things that we didn't really take into account. For example, we changed something in from the My Role policy. We basically changed the fact that where previously the user was actually running the what command was it? Let's have a look. The hostname command in the user domain, and we changed that to make the user run the hostname command in the hostname domain. Now, basically, by doing that, you might basically affect the remainder of the policy for a large extent, because actually you might not need some of these permissions, because those permissions were needed for by my login user to basically run the hostname command. But now that the hostname runs with a domain transition, these rules might no longer be needed. But since these rules are rather primitive, it's just reading the proc file system, generic files in the proc file system, reading generic files in the security file system, in the sysfs file system, the user files and stuff like that. You don't, we will just leave them there because that is no big deal. But really, to be honest, it probably doesn't need that stuff, because if you consider it, the user can't run any commands, and users by themselves don't do anything. They run commands, and the commands do stuff on behalf of the user. So the only thing that the user runs is a bash shell, and basically that would basically tell us that bash is basically reading the locales. Well, that's true, but and bash is reading hardware data. Bash is writing to the null device. Bash is trying to read the file, a password file. Well, that makes sense. And bash is basically reading the proc file system, which is also makes sense, but bash doesn't read the security file system, I don't think, to be honest, because and also basically the ID command is basically running the security reading security file system. So basically, since we are not allowing that, we basically don't have to allow this as well. But eventually we're not going to confine the ID command, I can tell you that already. But so we can leave this in, and we will leave this in, but just so you know that these rules are actually just needed by stuff that the user runs, not by the user itself. The user itself doesn't do anything, so these rules are not really user rules. These are just rules by that are needed by programs or shells that the user runs. But some of these rules are legit, since we allow the user to run the shell, the bash, any shells in the user domain. So this is legit. This isn't legit, because this was from previous policy that allowed the login user to run binary files, and that allowed the login user to actually run the ID command. Because if you saw that the ID command wasn't allowed to run, the user wasn't allowed to run the ID command, and the ID command runs the security file system, reads the security file system. So that was basically actually the ID command that does this. And the sysfs, this is probably also probably related to some command. Let's see, for example, if you go to the hostname type enforcement file, see if the hostname tries to read dev sysfs, and that's right. So here it is. So it might actually be the hostname command that wanted to read sysfs, and not the user. So we might actually be able to remove those rules. And the same goes for etc. Might actually be the hostname command that needed to read the etc files and not us, and so forth and so forth. And same Oh, syslog, and we didn't allow syslog, so that's fine. And same for localization, but I'm pretty sure that bash itself also needs to read localization. So and here the proc, list proc, but that's also needed by bash. So what we could try is just try remove the sysfs related, and we can also comment off, just basically comment them out, because we know that id command cannot run, so we probably don't need to read the security file system, and sysfs probably is run by the hostname command, and so we probably don't need that. So let's see, let's install that. Actually, let's just crap out of here, and we will also need to comment out the permissive rule for us to be able to check that. So we commented that, but later we'll probably still be adding it for one reason or another. And let's try and log in again. See, login still is allowed. Let's see if you have. Oh, and that's not there. Outed messages, and we'll just say 12:03. See, so it doesn't actually. So it's actually the hostname command that was reading the sysfs, but since we now are domain transitioning from the my login user T domain to the hostname domain when running the hostname command, we no longer need that. And the same applies for reading the security FS. Basically, we currently don't allow the user to run generic binary files, so it can't run the ID command. And it was actually the ID command that was trying to read the security FS. So since it can't execute ID, it won't need access to the security file system either. So just so you know that, it's just a reminder. So I can basically leave those I'm actually going to allow the security FS part, because we're going to run it in permissive next, and then it will be able to run the ID command. And so we know that security, this is for ID, so let's just make a note for ID command. And this, we're going to leave this uncommented for now, commented for now, because we know it was needed for the hostname command, which no longer runs in the user domain, but probably some other command will also need it. So was needed for hostname command, and the other stuff is probably all related to the shell, to your shell. So proc is probably related to the shell, password file is related to your shell, locale is related to your shell, hardware data, I'm not sure, but probably not related to the shell. Let's see. So we'll leave the remainder in. Not going to make it any harder than strictly needed, because we're going to have a lot of issues anyway. So and can basically, yeah, we'll leave this there. So let's just save and exit that. Oh, actually, I need to uncomment the permissive stuff. Why, actually, let's just keep it that way, because what we're going to do next is we're going to try and simply also now allow, and also conditionally allow the user to log in via the login program, which is basically done basically logging in via the TTI zero, via the TTIs, and that requires some changes. So as you can see, we have this basically these conditionals for SSH logins. So basically we can also add these for console logins, and in theory that should get us started to so SSH enable console login. Console login. And then basically now local login is that probably local login. I should basically just call this local login, enable local login. This makes it more makes more sense. Enable local login. However, I don't think the local login program uses dynamic transitions, so I assume that's the difference compared to the SSH program at daemon. So this is part of it, but there's more. Here we have the SSH login stuff. So let's see if we'll probably need some of this stuff for local login as well. The question is, what do we need? So we're going to remove a lot of this stuff, and we're just going to figure it out. It probably needs to do that, but I'll just figure it out. Let's just have a look at the upstream policy. User domain interface file, because basically this user domain base template basically takes care of both the SSH login as well as local login. So term user TTI, let's have a look at that. Terminal user TTI, user PTI, user TTI, then so here we have some stuff that term TTI, it's not needed. So and then you have here this console login stuff, local login. So this is let's paste that in. So type change when my login user T, and then it's going to be, and let's have a look at the policy again. User TTI device T. And then basically also require these types, console device T and user TTI device T. Okay. And so that's basically the equivalent of this rule for SSH, but then for local logins, console logins actually. And then basically just leave that here for us, remove this for now, but we're going to need that anyway. And then basically do the same. So here we have this, where basically the user must be able to write, to basically work with the user dev of sudo terminal, and we also need to basically do the same for the TTI device. Oh, actually, this also needed. So I'll just put that in as well. I could basically use brace expansion here, I think. Type TTI device T. I think we can use brace expansion here. TTI device T. Okay. So that takes care of that. Let's see what else we should take, keep in mind. Here, for example, yeah, so here is basically avoid annoying IO controls. So IO controls shouldn't be needed. So basically this user TTI device T is basically exactly the same as the user dev PTSD, so we can expand that as well. So we go below and basically expand this. And now it seems that we don't need the IO control here. So what we can do is don't audit my login user T, and then IO control, didn't audit IO control. That in theory that's what the policy upstream policy says, so let's just keep that as well. Okay, now what we did was let's just say dev PTS. TTI device, so basically the user TTI device, and you need to basically do that, require that user TTI device T. Oops, user TTI device. Okay, so that takes care of that. But the login program doesn't transition dynamically. It probably transitions on a shell. So let's have a look at the local login program. And that's a mess. Here you have that use DOM spec DOM trans all users, so we need to basically deal with that. User DOM spec DOM trans all users. Let's find that. User DOM spec DOM trans all users and see what's there. So there we have some stuff that we need to basically take care of. We need to basically take care of this, and we can basically get that from that. We can take that from SSH, because SSH actually I guess since SSH doesn't actually. Oh, here, no, that's not it. Since SSH doesn't actually domain transition on execute, I guess it might not need. That's the reason why it doesn't need these permissions. So, my login user. Using the file descriptions of local login t, and that's similar for these. My login user t local login t that we need to take care of. User T local login T, and then need to take care of the FIFO file. Where did we I'll just get it from here. Go back, and then this replace this with raw policy. Oops, FIFO file. And then just put that in there and edit that a little bit. Oops. And then we need to take care for somehow with the core command DOM trans. So here it's also core command shell spec DOM trans. Copy that. Close this. Go to the core command module, which is in the kernel layer. Core commands, and then find that interface. Find it. And then we need to domain transition pattern on shell exec. MISC patterns, domain transition pattern on shell exec. so it does, it uses set execcon, but it doesn't use setcon. And it's already allowed to transition. So it doesn't need an actual type transition rule, I guess. Let's just see where this gets us. Let's just see where this gets us. Now we need to take care of some stuff. We need to basically edit PAM access, because now we're basically also logging in locally. Then we're basically, so let's just do that first. Nano etc security access conf, and then just basically edit it to allow all logins for my login user, all, not except local. And then what we also need to do is set that boolean, get se bool, and then my login user, grab, enable local login, set se bool p local login on, and what else. I know I'm forgetting something. Oh yeah, default context. So that's CDETC. Oh, and I'm here there already. So what we're going to do is we're going to basically cut guests you and just add this one here to our my login user, nano my login user you. Just added that for local logins. My login user r, my login user t. And now just see where this gets us. I first see that I'm logged out of the remote session. This 12:25. I'll search MAVCTS 12:26. Make sure that that's clean, so that we don't get confused with other AVC denials. It still is 12:26, and we're clean. So let's just try. Send key F2. And then it's my login user. Cannot make remove an entry for the specified session. Okay, let's go back. And we have this key create stuff. So that was also for SSH, if you remember. But we basically left it out. Because we wanted to basically reproduce that. But if you look here in the SSH conditional block, here was that key stuff. So let's just assume that it meets all key stuff that SSH needs as well. So just take that, copy that, and then just paste that in, and I'll just and then local login instead of SSH. Let's see if that builds. Let's install that and then see if that takes us, gives us a little bit more room, takes us a little bit further. My login user, and then it's not, still not doing it right. Let's see what we have now. 28. We have some crap here. Audit to allow. And this seems to be needing this, can we can don't audit this. And we also did that for SSH, didn't we? We didn't for SSH, because SSH does a dynamic transition. And then just require this, but we don't actually need to require, do we? No, we don't. So that's there, but then the issue is here. Let's just try that out, see if it's related to that password file, or actually if it actually really needs to be able to run binary, generic binaries. Let's just allow my login user. Doesn't make sense. Password faulty. File, and then get attribute. Does it build? Builds. We need to figure out why it was hanging. And the only two hints we had was, well, because of the that it wasn't able to run generic binaries, and the other hint was that it couldn't get attribute of my login user. It's actually related to it not being allowed to run the ID command. Sucks. Sucks that it prevents that. that it prevents login just because it can't run the ID command. That's just bullshit. Yeah, see, it's just, and I'll grab BNT. It's so stupid. SSH doesn't have that problem. See, it just keeps on, right, it's also trying to read the profile there. So why is the profile there BNT? So we have more clues here. We have more clues. Let's go back. So it's trying to read the generic binary DIRS. So let's just, this is probably not related, but we're going to change that. BNT DIR read. Read. See if that's the problem. Oops. Damn. I need to build before I install, of course. Yeah, build before I install. It might be related that it can't read ETC profile. Not sure why it's crapping. It sucks though. See if there's hanging processes. Doesn't seem to be, so that's fine, that's cool. Alright, so let's try this again. See if that was the issue. My login user. Obviously not. Okay, back. Troubleshooting. 34. This is so stupid that if it would choke on. Oh, it's actually here. Open. Open the door. Open door. So add that as well. Still wasn't able to list it because wasn't able to open it. So this testing takes a lot of building and reloading and doing all kinds of stuff. And that really need to be able to enjoy this to actually do this stuff. You need to basically feel comfortable. Because otherwise it's not fun. Okay, so still not doing it. Let's see what else it's barking about. We go all the way below. Now it's actually failing on. See, it can't. The user bash can't. What? So stupid. The bash now wants to do all kinds of other stuff. So it's etc profile D. Make a note of that. And let's have a look at what's in there. Cause it's trying to command alpha run commands in there from there. Yep. So for this to work, we would need to create this with a different type. And that's where it gets real messy. Because we probably aren't able to change the context. Okay, let's go back. Damn, this is where it's getting messy already. So what we ideally want to do is basically create a type of use a different type for this location, so that we don't have to allow the user to run bin t just to make that stuff work. How should we go about that? Because it wants to use colors and stuff like that, and let's do all kinds of fancy stuff. So how are we going to deal with that? We're going to just try and see if we can override the context spec, but we can't, so that's just fucked up. There's just no other way to approach that, but we're going to try it anyway. So that we can basically also see the issues. So let's just say we're going to create a new type, which is profile binti. Now that still won't work. Unless we transition. So let's just see if type profile. That's a file type. So we'll just need to require attribute file type. This is going to get messy. And then type attribute profile binti, because it's still not going to work, because those shell scripts there probably will run binti stuff anyways. File type. And then basically make the profile file t profile binti binti an entry point to the my login user so that it can run it in the my login user. Nano my login user pp fc etc profile d. Let's just do it differently, because I know how this how they work, how this is done, so I'm going to cheat this. System U object R, and then profile bin T. So I'm not actually duplicating it, and then we need to escape this period here, else it won't catch it. And then go back to the type enforcement file, and then just change that. This is just binti. Let's see if I can cheat the system. Let's see if I can cheat the system. Restore com r v f etc profile, and now it's basically resetting everything. Oops, etc profile d, resetting it to our new type here. Now let's see how that affects us. Whether that enables us to log in. Probably not. Probably this is all not working. You see? Oh, admin console type. But we are getting, maybe we might be getting somewhere. Damn, this is why it's getting so complicated. And well, really nice if you're just playing around a little bit. So let's just see what the outsert says. 46. It needs to run console type. It's actually running RPM. But grab console type. Grab console type. She's trying to run consult type. Let's see if we have a policy for consult type that we can abuse. Probably in apps. Or admin. Here it is. So if we can do a consult type DOM trans, domain transition. DOM trans pattern, so that we get this stuff again, which we have for host name. So we can basically steal from host name there. So host name, where are you? Host name. Where is that stuff here? This stuff. Basically, copy that in. And then just make that put that in the conditional here. That's getting ugly. I should really use git for version control so that I can easily revert, because now it's getting really messy. Right, so we have console type T here. Console type T. Console type exact T. Console type exact T. And then basically console type T. Type T. Console type. And this is just this will get even worse. Oops. This will get even worse. Because this is really, we're hoping that console type doesn't actually run any significant commands on behalf of the user. Because if it does, then we're screwed. Then we need to use prefixes here as well. Roll. Line 121. We need to probably require that role. See if that doesn't make sense though. Actually, you probably can't use this in a conditional. That sucks. So that means that we, whoops, also need to so we don't have to require the console type. Oh, actually, it oh yeah. Messy type. Really ugly. See if where this gets us. Unknown type, console type. Now we need to also require it there, I guess. So we need to require it both. Oh no, we don't. That was just stupid. Damn. Need to enter the sudo password again, probably because it's stuff timed out again. See where this gets us. Login users global requirements were not met. Type attribute control console type exactly. My login uses global requirements. Okay, so that type doesn't exist. Well, it does exist. The hell? Where is console type exactly? Optional. Not sure. Then in there, the boolean. If in there. We're already getting into some of the nasty nasty things. Of defining desktops. and see if this even works. Seems to work. Let's see if the rule is actually in the policy. Asset search, ASCT source is my login user T, and then grep for console type. Grep console type. Console type. And no, it's not. This is something that's really that is inherent of oh right, and then there's a bug there. But that's not it, probably. It's not related, probably. So, for some reason, it doesn't actually add the optional policy. So I'm not sure how that optional stuff works in raw policy. Already now we're already messing with nested conditionals, really. With nested conditionals, and we're not even getting started yet. Wow. And still, it doesn't do it. Shit. This sucks. So you have twofold problem. Yeah, you can't do the use the roles and conditionals. Actually, that doesn't make sense. You should be able to use that in conditionals. In optionals, no, not in conditional shit. And I can't undo, of course. That stuff sucks. Jesus Christ. Role my login user role and then types console type t. Why oh why oh why oh why? The console type is a type that is declared in the base policy. Is that the reason why I can't use it in a boolean? That might just well be it. Or am I just overlooking some stupid typo? Either or. Jesus Christ. Just isn't optional. Yeah, the type doesn't even exist. All right. Jesus Christ. Looks like Fedora removed it. Fuck. So what turns out is that I'm basically working in a Fedora system with Fedora policy, but I'm looking, referencing the ref policy, which is the upstream policy. Now some bright guy at Fedora decided to remove the console type module, because it's not in Fedora. As in module list grep console. And this basically makes it so that I can't fuck. fucking use it. Which makes my life miserable. Because I need to be able to run console type. Else, I'm not able to log in using the TTI. But no. So basically, what I need to do is create a new domain. Fuck. Thanks, Dan. So instead of basically running that's all these issues that you get to deal with if you wanna go find that stuff. And I'm not even sure if this is actually going to make it work. If this actually makes sense. This is just one issue. Imagine all the other programs and commands. And I'll probably need a domain because else you can't transition. So make profile bin permissive for now. What a mess. Console type type still somewhere. Yeah. Probably won't be able to restore the context of etc profile D because I changed the file type into process type and all kinds of shit. So set up for 0, restore, colon RVF etc profile D. Okay, now center four is 1, and let's see where this gets us. My login user. And it doesn't even help. So we're going to back to square 0. We're going to undo all this mess. To get rid of the profile stuff. Oh, and there, that entry point is also not right. But nonetheless, we're just going. We're just not being able to. Not able to log in. Without access to generic binary. So. So let's just make a note here. Local logins don't work without access to bin T. Eventually we're going to have to allow bin T anyways, but for now that's just something that we need to basically accept. So unlike SSH where you can basically log in without access to bin T, that doesn't work for in confined mode. That doesn't work for local login. But the transition happens. So we took care of that. It's just not as clean as I would like to. So if all is well, then at least the and I'm going to test that. So it sets. Let's just try that again. My login user. Works. Exit. Testing 20. Let's just look at that and out it to Y. That's what else, what all at once. Out to allow, sorry. Christ. So this is these are all the permissions it actually needs. It's not much. So that's so we went to all this pain for very little permissions. See what, why it's trying, yeah, well, it's trying to list etc. But what? Let's see. Crap etc. And it's actually listing, what? Business doesn't have that. Okay, save it. So that's basically the end of this chapter. Oh, and I need to actually. Oh no, no. That's basically the end of this chapter. So we basically made the local login work, a quote work unquote. But we still we just exclude bin, because we need to basically we can't just allow bin yet. We need to basically see what all it runs and what's worth to confine of what it runs. So, but eventually that's going to pan out. That's going to work fine. So, I blame Dan for removing the console type module. But after now, I'll admit my mistake that it wasn't really worth to have a console type module because, well, it could have made life a little bit easier. But eventually, it doesn't matter that it's gone. So. Okay, with that said, I'm going to close off part two. So what we basically did in this part was basically support local logins. So in the first chapter we just supported SSH logins, and in this chapter we supported local logins. So basically in the next chapter we're going to have to support TDM stuff or yeah, window manager, login manager stuff. And then it's when it's getting really ugly. So yeah, that's it for now.